our series of the English novel in its process of growth, this may be the working title also, and can be interpreted properly in the context, is on. And today we are taking up the aspect of early English fiction, and we will get help from Aphra Behn, the reference to this great novelist of the 17th century. And then, you know, we can go to the novel for which she is known. I wouldn't say that this is the first English novel. In fact, English novel formally is launched, if at all the word can be used, only in the 18th century. But then the novel that came up in the 18th century had its roots in the previous years, previous decades. And suddenly, not that the novel form erupts in English literature, it is that it is a kind of climax of a process that started much earlier. And in that sense, I particularly refer to Aphra Behn because, well, she is a woman, and a woman writing in the 17th century is very rare. And she is writing professionally, she is writing to sell. She is writing to be read. She is writing to offer a perspective on the life that she lives and the life that surrounds her. So all these things are there. So I'll use this example to reflect upon the issues that early English fiction raised, and of which it was a result also when those issues were worked out by society in its time. So. There is early English fiction, which is a kind of precursor to, a kind of predecessor to the novel that you know, took shape in the concrete sense in the 18th century in the hands of writers like Fielding. And this particular reference is going to be helpful tremendously in understanding the nature of the English novel. I start with the short biographical reference to, of this writer in the context. She is born in 1640. That's the year, you know, when the war of the two sections of monarchy and anti-monarchy sections, that is on, either directly in the battlefield or in the society of the time, where, you know, these things are being marshaled as opinions. So 1640 is that kind of a year. It's a critical year in English history. It is the end of, let's say, the metaphysical poetry, and very soon after 1640, you know, all the activity of the plays, of entertainment, of pleasure that people were seeking in literature, would be over, would be banned, and that way there is a threat to, let's say, the growth of English literature. In 1640, because people are divided. There are a large number of masses, you know, who want to now understand Christianity, want to understand social life, want to assert themselves in one way. And there are monarchical forces, forces of the for the king, you know, which are very deadly, very violent, very cynical, I would say. It's a very corrupt regime at the time. And the people at the top of the society are not exactly popular with the masses. So that's the time when this author is born, and the author is a woman, and she comes from not England, the center of England, that is London, but she comes from Canterbury, Kent. Her origins were humble, and there is no record of her family, and particularly her early years. This is important. Suddenly she emerges, let's say, in the 1660s, and 70s later. But then I thought I should focus upon these years for the reason, you know, that they were critical years, as I said, and they had a lot of, you know, up and down in society. So nobody keeps record of all the unimportant people in society, and particularly in the hinterland, in the rural areas. So nobody knows on which particular day she might have been born, who were her parents, and all these things are now in the region of what can be called oblivion. So I say that being a woman was another hurdle in Behn's personal progress. What do I mean by personal progress? Well, unless you are a person, unless you are a thinking individual in society, unless you have got some kind of an education, a basic education to read and write, you know the tradition of writing, you know the tastes of people, you know to what extent already literary expression has evolved, all these things have to be known. So that is, if you have more of them, then you have skills, then you can communicate better, then you can leave a great deal of impact on the reader. So this I call personal progress. And being a woman, personal progress is a difficult thing for her. Nobody will, encourage her, will inspire her. In fact, all of us know that till the 19th century, women writers were not taken seriously. And in fact, I wonder whether women in the 19th century would have been able to tell people that because they were women and they were writing, therefore people should read them. So being a woman in the 17th century is much more difficult than it was in the 19th century for obvious reasons. And these things, you know, would have told us about, would have made clear to us about the grit that she had, the power that she had, the confidence that she had. And it's a woman who is writing, it's a woman who is active in the field of culture. And well, there are lots of other problems with this author, because she was widely traveled in the 17th century, and she had certain missions, and she was a kind of spy also once, you know, and she was representing England elsewhere in society and in the world. So it's not an ordinary woman, and all that she achieves, all that she gets in life, earns recognition, earns bread and butter, is able to live, is able to enjoy security and protection. All these things, you know, make this person herself very heroic. Anyway, these are the years when she evolves, and then the next year in her life, she would be 9 years then, is the Republican regime happens following civil war. Now, these two things contribute to the writing of a different kind. You know, when there is republicanism, then the power, you know, shifts from the upper classes to the ordinary masses. Life led by the ordinary masses is in any case controlled by the state. But when the state is in the hands of royalty, in the hands of the monarch, in the hands of the court in London, in a city, then life is has a lot of discipline. People have to always think twice before they speak. There is a kind of control. People are afraid of the powers that be. And when civil war happens, the opposite thing takes place. So there is a civil war, and on one side are the Republicans, the people, you know, who have direct contact with the masses. So these are her formative years, 1640 when she is born, up to 1660 when she is 20. And these are times of upheaval, and Cromwell at that time is the dictator. It's a very strange word used for him. He is a dictator, but he is a dictator on behalf of the masses. So which means that he dictates terms not exactly to the ordinary masses from whom, you know, he derives power, but from the upper classes, people, you know, nobility. He is the dictator to them. He is removing them one by one. He is taking their property away. He is putting that property to social use. He is making policies that you know, will uphold and let science, for instance, progress in the 17th century. And because of Cromwell's policies for 8 or 9 years, those policies, England would become a different society altogether, because there will be an emphasis on science, there will be an emphasis on production, trade will develop in that society, and earlier traders who were at the beck and call of the monarch, those traders are now getting independence. And if traders are independent in society, Some independence also goes to the masses, because traders are in direct touch with, the ordinary people. So traders are becoming more and more powerful, more and more influential in that society. And Cromwell is the center of this power that now shifts from the nobility and the court and the king to the traders. So Cromwell and the influential parliament. Have you heard of a parliament anywhere in the world in the 17th century or 16th century? Their kind, the word may have been used, but this was generally the court earlier. And there is a proper parliament in England in 1649, when the king is not merely dethroned, he is done to death, and he loses, his coterie, the supporters that he had, most of them and the upper ones have to run away from England, and it is now totally in the hands of the Parliament, and Cromwell is at the helm of affairs, and he is now making policies that will help the traders, that will help the trade, that will help the industry, that will help the world of knowledge, because knowledge cannot be gained by faith. Knowledge can be gained only by hard intellectual work, and Cromwell is that way for that historical progress, which is based on production, which is based on distribution of wealth, shifting of wealth from those who believe in luxury to those people who use wealth in order to create, let's say, jobs, create work for the masses. More and more money now is going into the hands of the middle classes. In fact, the middle classes are born around this time. Now, directly I am talking about the economic aspect of society at that time, but indirectly I am talking about the masses who are moving gradually from the periphery, from the margins, from far away places in the country called England to the center somewhere. And that center obviously is the center of trade, and it is operating from London. So 1649 is that year, and this young girl of 9 years is watching all this happening before her eyes, and she is an ordinary person. So you can imagine that she represents the ordinary masses at that time. And then, you know, something else happens after 11 years, that is 1660, and the entire thing is once again upturned. Now monarchy is back into the fold, and Cromwell dies. His son is not able to continue with the policies of his father. And the Parliament was ruling supreme, but the Parliament wanted now not a great leader from their own masses, they wanted a figurehead to lead it. Imagine, the Parliament is wanting a figurehead to lead it. What does it mean? It means the Parliament doesn't want a leader. The Parliament wants to run on its course by itself, and they will only get a kind of a nod from the monarch. And how do they get that monarch? Well, they contact the son of the dead king who ran to the son had already run to France. So he is invited back to become the king. Have you ever heard in life that a king is invited by the masses, by the Parliament, to come and rule them? Who is the appointing authority? The Parliament. Parliament has its power coming from the masses. Therefore, in a way, the English society now is appointing its own king, and that king has to just be there in the name. He is just a rubber stamp. He is just an ordinary authority, ordinary menial in the hands of the Parliament, and the whole work now will be decided, operated upon, done. Implementation of the policies, all this will happen by the Parliament, in the hands of the Parliament. So that is restoration for us. So Behn at that time is 19 years. When restoration happens, she is 20 years, and this is her formative period. Now I ask a question from myself, I ask a question from her, from you. At the age of 20, restoration happens, the king comes back. And with that, you know, the policies will change again. The years in question were marked by these 20 years that I am talking about, 1640 to 1660, they were marked by socio-political and ideological changes. Socio-political, all of us know that the king is not there for some time. Half the time in these 20 years, the king is not there. The Parliament itself is functioning. The leader of the Parliament is dictating policies that will support the middle classes and the masses. And this is the socio-political angle. What is the ideological angle? What has happened in these 20 years? The first 10 years, let's say, are marked by the presence of Puritanism. Puritanism, what is it? There are Puritans, they were there as Protestants in the 16th century, and in the 17th century, in the first half, started calling themselves, a large section of them started calling it what can be called Puritan. The word is clear and simple. The word is they want to lead a pure life, and pure life happens only in the case of true Christians. And if there are no true Christians in society, then how does purity come? This is the question you have to think. This is the question that I have to think. Because Puritans were saying, be pure in life, be moral in life, always be dictated by the essence of religion, not by the ordinary words of religion, but the essence of it, the truth of it. And who will, interpret, who will explain what truth is, who will define the truth? And that is Puritans say it will be defined by the individual. The individual will read the Bible, the individual interpret the Bible. He might take help from a preacher, he might take help from an interpreter, but then the final authority of knowing the truth of the Bible, of Christianity, will be in the hands of the individual. That is Puritanism. And Puritans, in any case, and Christianity in general, were against immorality. As all of us know, the core of religion is that impure people have no right to live. Impure people have to be castigated, have to be criticized. And this is the essence of Christianity also. So Puritans, they said, you know, that most of the people are impure. Therefore, and who were spoiling the people, who were making them immoral? And they thought that, you know, generally if you have more money, generally if you enjoy life, then your morals are loosened, they lose their grip on us. And therefore, no entertainment is allowed, no pleasure is allowed. Always be serious, always read, you know, holy books, always follow the path of truthfulness. This is what Puritans will say. That's a problem, because human beings, of course, are hardworking. Human beings also think, but they also believe in pleasure. So that is the problem with Puritanism at that time. So Puritans become quite unpopular in the first 10 years of the rule of Cromwell. His policies are good. He is increasing production and some kind of industrialism. He is creating a base for industrial production. Now that is good for society. But at the same time, he is using the power of the masses. And his followers, the people who support him, they are supporting Puritan ideals. So he has the charisma. He was a great leader. If he had not been there in the 17th century, England wouldn't have been at the helm of affairs for the next two centuries or three centuries. So that way, he is a great thinker and seer. He is a visionary. There is no doubt about that. But then he is getting support from the Puritans. And Puritans being, messengers of morality that they see in the Bible, that they see in a religious book, these Puritans become more and more unpopular. Now, this is the catch, you know, that is there in this lecture. And I'd like to say finally that this catch can be explained in terms of the importance and relevance of a different kind of literary form. Anyway, that will come at the end of this lecture, but at the moment let me tell you that these 20 years are important both for England and for our author Aphra Behn. And I then read the second sentence. In the main, religion was at the center of the contemporary discussion that at that time was there. Then that had to be talking point, and people were discussing it. Who were these people who were discussing it? Well, the ordinary masses. And the masses lived both in the cities and in the villages. So a kind of debate continued at that time there, and that, you know, brought in the people in the forefront of the English society. And I end this lecture by, just explaining further the challenges that world of expression, the world of literature faced at the time. And the last point that I make is that the clash was between Puritanism and freedom, the latter a new phenomenon that had indeed been unleashed by the rule of new law, where affairs were directed and determined by secular ideals. So this is the clash. The clash is between freedom on one side and serious engagement with society on the other. So many people will opt for freedom. The poor souls, the poor people, the moral ones would support Puritanism. So I would say that there is a kind of divide in society at the time. On the one side are the Puritans who have their base in the villages, and on the other side are the freedom seekers and entertainment seekers and pleasure seekers whose base is urban England. And this clash now is going to take ideas further in the direction of the masses. And those ideas, you know, require a new form. Now, heroic poetry will not do. drama will not do. Now a new form is to emerge, and that form should be able to define the ideals of the masses through dialogue, through discussion, through analysis. And you combine all these things, and you talk about the masses. When people are reading books, then they would like to read about their life. So a new form is to be born, and that is early fiction. And the first example, one of the first examples of fiction, novel, the story. These examples are actually the examples of the writing of Aphra Behn in particular, and her contemporaries such as John Bunyan. And let's say that it's very convenient for us to say that John Bunyan is for the Puritanism, and Aphra Behn is for Restoration, and these two will then project a new form at this time when novel has not come as an established form, but they are paving the way for the novel to become a major form in the coming centuries. Thank you.